the world before Jesus comes. It's wars and rumors of wars. And all you have to do is, I don't care what day it is, you turn on your television, you're going to hear about war, rumors of war. It's happening. It's happening. We're hearing the pressures coming against Israel. And just the other day, I don't know whether you heard it or not, but the Muslims are wanting to take over the mount where they have the mosque of Omar and so on it. And they want to turn it into a Muslim shrine, even though they know that the Jews want to build their temple back there. And as I read that, I was hearing that, I said, God, what kind of war is that going to bring on? We're already watching it all over the world. And God is saying to the church, this is no time to play games. This is a time to be in prayer. This is to be a time to spend time with God. Even if you're driving in the car or as she said, at work or whatever, you've got to take time. You've got to take time. And there's no excuse for not having time.
That's right.
Because of the day in which we live. You know, my brother and I have an older sister, and she fell and broke her leg up by her hip. And she's in the hospital still, and I called her last night just to see how she was doing. But when I did, all of a sudden I felt an urgency to pray for her. But you know what? It wasn't so much for God to heal her, but God visit her. She's lying there.
Amen.
You minister to her. I talked to her daughter, and as I talked with Susan, I was saying, Susan, she's telling me, you know, I have to watch, took a look over Mom and take care of Mom. I said, Susan, that's wonderful. But you've got to be praying for your mom, and you've got to be praying about this. You know, it's so urgent. That young lady said she saw these tornadoes coming. And I don't know about you, but every once in a while when I'm watching the weather report, they're always showing the tornadoes out west and how they're devastating houses and whole communities and,
yes,
and all this kind of stuff. And I got to thinking when I was listening to her yesterday, and she's talking about tornadoes coming, and I thought, God, you're talking about devastation of our world.
Yes.
Well, that's what Scripture's talking about. This world is not going to survive. There's going to be a new heavens and a new earth. But this earth is going to be destroyed. And we're watching that. And God is showing us these symbols so that we will wake up to the reality of it. Esther, you want to say something? Sure. And I'll tell you what, I've really been praying for you younger ones around here, for you to hear from God, not just us old people. Come on, Adonis.
Well, I got this word a few weeks ago while I was listening to music as I work, and it goes, He is doing a new thing. Do not wait anymore. Get on your hands and feet and call on the Lord. Go quickly, wash your garments, press them and get ready. The groom is coming for his bride. Keep oil in your lamps and keep watch. He's doing a new thing. No time to be offended. Sink in with his heart. Proclaim his love. Do not be silent. Gather the bride from far and wide. He is coming. He is coming. No longer as lamb, now a lion.
Amen.
He is jealous for his bride. Do not grow weary, for he is doing a new thing. Can you not hear it? Can you not perceive it? Here comes the children and the child, the final stroke on the canvas.
Amen. One of the statements that I wrote down here was that she made was, God saying, I'm giving you a chance to change. You know what? I don't think he's going to give us many more chances.
Amen.
When we get chances like this, when we get messages like this, it's God saying, now's the time for change. I'll tell you what I want you to do. I want you to get up out of your seats, and I want you to come down here to the altar.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
I just think the word that Deb got this morning, we're on a mission. We have a mission. But it's, then I got the word commission. that God has, what's the difference between commission? He's commissioned us for a mission, I guess.
Yes.
Yeah. And we heard that really loud and clear this morning.
I've been having dreams every night of young people sweeping out their houses, sweeping out their houses, sweeping out their houses. Mm. Still listening, Lord.
Get your house in order.
That's right.
Get the garbage out of your house.
Yes. Amen.
Get your house in order. Getting your personal life in order.
Specifically young people? Young people. In their teens, their 20s, you know, and up to 30 years old.
We can even talk to 40 and they're still young.
Well, wait a minute. But specifically, God zeroed me in on those people.
Amen.
The ones that are going out partying and having a good
just
time.
Like what she was talking about.
Exactly what she was saying.
Now, I don't know what condition you're in, personally. You may have to do some repenting, and I think all of us have to.
Always.
Because we're too preoccupied with other things rather than the lost soul that may be sitting next to us at work or the friend of ours or neighbor who's lost. And God's talking to us. And I really believe that he's wanting to get our attention. Because we're getting too preoccupied with other things. And God is saying, no, the end is coming. Get in focus. You had your hand up.
Yes, it was just yesterday. Me and one of my coworker was talking, and I was telling him about the pastor of the church should function and to get the church in order and get the people in order, because he was saying he know of a pastor that died with all the church money strapped to his body and all of that. And I thought he was joking. And he said, no, it's true. And when I heard that, I just go through 1 Corinthians and a whole lot of scriptures. And that was our conversation yesterday. And this was a pastor that died that way. And you know Jamaican, so it could be in different terms and language, but it is true. He said it's no joke.
And the Holy Spirit had me call a friend of mine in Pennsylvania. She has children who are pastors, are married to pastors. And I was speaking to her exactly about all of this. She said, I'm going to pass the word on. So, because they haven't really been discussing it up there.
I just want to say that Bill has trained all of us on the what the blood of Jesus really is. And so when you get up in the morning, pray that over our whole church.
Amen.
Plead the blood of Jesus over us.
Always. Yes. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Very important.
And the other thing, I always carry the prayer of salvation in these little pieces of paper. If you're with somebody or in your office or something, you can just leave them there. They'll curiously ask you, what is this?
Amen. Give
them out.
Yeah. If you recall, the word for our Made for More conference in the fall is the word outrageous.
Yes.
When the Lord first gave that to us, I thought that has a double meaning. Mm-hmm. But I thought, if Christians are going to be what she was talking about today, that's pretty outrageous. The world will look at us and say, "Well, that's outrageous." Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what's happening in our world is outrageous.
Yes.
And then when we're having a prayer meeting, the word got divided up into out, go out, and because of the rage that Satan has, and then it's us. Mm-hmm. And that stuck with me. But last Sunday, Katie said to me, I did something outrageous. I saw this man in the restaurant, okay? And he looked like he needed some food, so I paid for his food. We got him some food. We fed him, and he didn't have any place to sleep, so I got him a hotel room. Now, I'm a single woman. Here's a strange guy. And I found him a hotel room, and I said I would pick him up for church in the morning. He was able to take a shower. And she picked him up for church. She said, that was for me, that was outrageous.
Amen.
That was really outrageous for me. Yeah. So we bring him to church, and then what happened? What happens next he becomes born again. You know, Kevin talks with him, and your friend that was with you. Mm-hmm. And you said he was, you know, the man has had some background. I think he might have told you that. Because he was asking Katie, is this a spirit-filled church?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And do they move in the gifts of the Spirit? And so he knows the lingo.
He knows, yeah.
So he knew something, but he was so far away from God. You saw him last night? What happened last night? I didn't know about that.
He showed up at the... he was picked up by the Maldonado team downtown.
Oh, yes. Uh-huh.
And they brought him to the stage last night at the convention center.
Really?
And so when he saw me, he jumped off the stage and ran into my arms.
Amen.
So that's pretty outrageous.
Yeah, you're right.
That's good. Yeah, that's wonderful.
But you see, that's what God's asking
us
to do.
Amen.
Amen.
We've got to go. We have to get out there. We just have to.
And God, I just, we stand here this morning. You're telling us that we need to get ready. And I don't know, Father, the condition of these people's lives. Only you know. And I ask you, God, if they're standing here and there's sin, if they're standing here and they've been so preoccupied with self that they've forgotten you and the lost world out there, and they only pray for their personal needs and don't pray for a lost world, that God, that you begin something inside of us, Holy Spirit. Begin to change the way we think. Begin to change the way we talk. Begin to change the way we value things as to what's important and what's not important.
Hallelujah.
And Father, that we will begin to get the concept of God. That we will realize what you consider valuable. And not what we consider valuable, but what's valuable to you. And undoubtedly the world was so valuable, you were willing to send your son to die for us. And so your concern is for that whole world out there around us here in Palm Beach County that's going to hell. Going to hell. So many today caught up in everything else, but they're not in church and not seeking God. And Father, I'm even concerned about those who go to church, but in their own hearts, they've not asked you to forgive them of their sin and they've not really come to Jesus. But God, I ask you to change us. I ask you to change every one of us as we're standing here. Holy Spirit, come. Change the way we think. Change the way we talk. Change where our value system is. Change all these things in our minds and our hearts that we'll realize that those tornadoes are blowing.
Yes,
they're blowing and they're not that far away. It's not going to be long before the trumpet sounds to warn us that it's time to leave.
Hallelujah.
And there's not going to be time to get ready after the trumpet sounds. And so, God, I pray that you'll, oh, Holy Spirit, that you will come and convict us and convince us and stir us. And God, not only us, but I think of family members. I think of friends and neighbors, people we talk to about other things. But we don't talk to them about salvation. And God, help us. If necessary, give us night dreams that will haunt us. Whether they're tornadoes or whatever's immaterial, but something that will wake us up. And God, if there are loved ones, people of our own families that aren't saved, that we'll become so driven to pray for their salvation.
Yes, Lord.
That we'll become so caught up in the role of intercessors for them to see that they are saved and make the kingdom. Yes. And we don't want them to be lost.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
And if you can do it and feel like it, I'd like for you to kneel if you can. And some already have it. But perhaps you can do that in that kneel, that position of humility, humbling yourself before God. It's not that you're humbling yourself before people. And if you can't kneel, sit down. But and I'll just stick my Bible under the chair. Oh, God.
Hallelujah.
Oh, God.
The Lord is saying, be ready for the suddenness.
Amen.
The suddenness of any moment.
Yes.
Not just for the suddenness of his return, but the suddenness of any situation that you find yourselves, ourselves in at this hour and at this time. Mm. There is no substitute for righteousness. There is no substitute for righteousness. The life, abiding life of God's righteousness within you is your only hope. That is the hope. That is the hope. So be abidingly, constantly ready for the suddenness of the experiences that the Lord so deems necessary for this hour in Jesus' precious name.
Amen. Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, God. God, I can't help but feel that you ordained this morning just like this. Because, God, all of us need to get the fire stirring within us. Realizing that your coming is so soon, Jesus. It's so soon. You're showing it to us all around us. You're showing it in the fulfillment of biblical prophecy. You're showing it to us. Jesus, help us. Don't let us be the same when we walk out of here today. We will not be the same. And we'll have a whole renewed thinking for tomorrow, for today, this afternoon, this evening. God, that somehow you, Holy Spirit, will begin to haunt us, even in our dreams or in our sleep or whatever, but drive us to that realization that we wake up and understand that the time is short, that Jesus is coming and there's no time to waste. No time to waste. There's a whole world out there going to hell. There's a whole world out there going to hell. And God, help us that we're not going to be critical of other people. We're going to look at ourselves in the mirror and take a look at that. Oh, Jesus.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Seize it. Now, Father, we just come before you, Lord God, and we ask for your forgiveness, Father. Cleanse us with the blood of Jesus, Father God. Oh, Lord, let our will be your will, Father, in our lives, Father. I thank you, Lord God, that you are leading and guiding and directing us, Father. I pray, Father, that you will speak to each one of us, God, and show us our full purpose, Lord God. Let us not ignore the voice of the Holy Spirit when he speaks to us. Yes. Father, I pray. Father, I pray a rising up of our spirit man in the name of Jesus. Father, may we put our flesh to death, Father God. Father, you made us body, soul, and spirit, but you made us spirit, soul, and body, Father. So, Lord, I pray that would be how it would be, Lord God. Father, that we would only hear your voice, Lord God, and we would do only your will, Father, not our will, in the name of
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And I just thank you, Father.
Thank you, Jesus.
We cry out to you, my God, for your mercy and for your grace, my God. For covering, my God.
Your kids are kneeling before you.
In our lives, my God. Covering, my God, in the lives of these children, Father, my God. Covering. In the lives of our family members, our friends, those who don't know you. God, we call out for them. We cry out for them, my God. We ask you to save their souls, my God. We ask, my God, that you awaken them at night, that you'll make yourself real to them, Father, in the name of Jesus. That they will stop, my God, every activity that is not of you. Anything, my God, in their lives, in our lives, my God, that's not of you. Awake us
us to it, my God. Awake us to it, Lord, to remove it, my God, in the name of Jesus. Oh, we turn to you, my God. We turn to you, God, with our whole hearts. My God, with our souls. We turn to you. We bring our children before you. We offer them to you, God. Take them and seal them, God. Your salvation. Take them, young and old. Take them, oh God. Save them, my God. Children, both young and old, young teenagers, adult children of the families in this room, in this church. Save our children. Save our families. Oh, my God, in the name of Jesus.
God, my God, my God, my God.
We give this, my God. We repent, my God, of being distracted, of being diverted, my God. We repent, my God. Forgive us. Forgive me. Forgive us, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Be our everything. Be our covering, my God.
Hide us, my God, in your secret place. Yes.
Yes.
We lay down our lives. Oh, dear Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for this moment with you, Lord Jesus. You open our eyes, you open our hearts, you open our minds to everything that is you. We pray that we are not complacent, oh Lord Jesus. That you fill us with the Spirit. You open our eyes to what you need us to see and to hear. That we are not held back by our fears. That we are bold. That we are outrageous. Help us, Lord Jesus. Help us, for we need you in our everyday walk. You are everything. And too often we get too caught up in the world. You know we pray to you, Lord Jesus. We take our times, but sometimes we get caught up. Forgive us, Lord Jesus. Open our hearts so that we can reach out to others. Not be afraid to speak your truth. What is important, Lord, is that we are patient as well. That we are not filled with fear. That we do not have heartaches that keep us from speaking the truth of your glory. You are everything, Lord Jesus. You are all that is and shall ever be. You are there in our relationships. You are there with our loved ones. Help us speak to them the truth of your glory. You are all that is and shall ever be. You are Alpha and Omega. Let us not be afraid to come to you, for you are our strength. You are our renewal of our spirits. You help us when we are hurt. You help us when we are awake. You help us when we are asleep. Let us be forever ready to hear you, seek you, to open our spirits to your presence. You fill our lives. You fill our loves. You are there when we are hurting. You are there when we are filled with joy. If only we just open ourselves to you. We seek you in everything that we do. We honor you with our thoughts and our prayers. Help us touch those around us who still do not believe or still not open. Help us touch their hearts with the truth of your presence. It is in you, Lord Jesus, that we gain wisdom, understanding, love, and cherishment. Let us always be willing to share that in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
I feel the great thing that God's trying to say to us is
Hallelujah.
this is not the end of it. This is just the starting. And he wants this to continue in our lives. He wants us to become real intercessors. Not something that we do once a week on a Wednesday night or something.
Hallelujah.
But that this becomes a whole part of our lives. Because of our lost children, of our lost grandchildren, of our family members that are gone, that are gone. And God, we call them and we ask you, Holy Spirit, to send someone to visit them, to knock on their door, to reach out and touch them, that somehow that they will be drawn by the Holy Spirit and their lives will be changed.
Yes,
we realize the time is short. The time is short. We don't know how much time there is. But God, we're crying out for family. We're crying out for our children, our grandchildren. We're crying out for them, Lord. We're crying out for our siblings that are not saved today. They're lost. They're on their way to hell. And God, we know it. We know it. But God, help them, stop them somehow. Somehow, Holy Spirit, step into their lives. Send somebody into their lives. Cause them to have an experience with God. Where change will come. Where change will come. It's God, not just us being ready. It's the family being ready. It's the friends being ready. It's the neighbors being ready. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. That we realize that there's no guarantee of tomorrow. No guarantee of tomorrow. God, so we cry out for them. We cry out for them. Especially those that know better, those that know the truth. Those that maybe one time walked with you, but today they're not. Holy Spirit, become the hound of heaven. And grant them no peace, but haunt them.
Sue them
till they cry out from their own hearts to you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Because of the conviction of the Holy Spirit coming upon them.
Yes, Lord.
Oh God.
Yes, Lord.
Somehow. And for those that we can't personally reach because we're not by them, and maybe a telephone call would help, but maybe it won't either. But God, we ask you to send somebody into their lives. Send somebody into their lives. Maybe somebody they work with, or their child, some or young person, somebody at school that they go to school with. But God, it's harvest time.
Yes, Lord.
Your word told us, don't say they're 4 months and come the harvest. Your word said, open your eyes and look, the fields are white. Already unto harvest. And I know we've been hearing that for 2,000 years, but God, somehow I get that urgency now. This is the time. This is the time. This is the time. This is the time. This is the time.
Hallelujah.
Cry out to you, Lord. Cry out to you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Oh God. Oh God.
Hallelujah.
Right now, my Lord Jesus, we stand, O God, in this place of authority and of dominion, power, Lord. And we agree with heaven, my Lord Jesus, and right now we legislate in the heavens, Lord God. And we give the angels charge, O God, over our loved ones who will not hear us. Lord, arrest them, O God. Arrest them, O God. Pull them in, O God, in the name of Jesus. O God, visit with them, O God, as only you know how. We legislate now in the heavens. We set at liberty, O God. God, shed an end, O God, all of the heavenly hosts, O God. O Lord, it is all about life and salvation, eternal life. Oh God, eternal life, eternal life, eternal life, eternal life. Yes, God, we go on the life watch this day. We go on the life watch now, my God. We speak life and liberty and hope. Oh God, for eternal salvation, eternal readiness, oh God. In Jesus' name.
of your presence. Lord God, we speak your courts. Oh God, your courts, Lord. Oh God, your judgeship, your kingship, Lord. But we plead, Lord God, for mercy and grace, oh Lord Jesus. But Lord Jesus, we speak to the hard hearts, Lord God, that they shall be humbled before you, Lord God. And in that case, Lord Jesus, we loose them to you, Father, that you will do what is necessary to draw them into the truth of their situation, Lord. Ah, Lord, that they shall truly know the dangerous places that they are in and the areas, Lord, of their lives that need to be corrected and repented for, Lord. I speak, Lord Jesus, specifically, Lord, of those who are cohabiting without the benefit of the marriage ceremony, without the benefit of the family unit that you created, Lord Jesus. I speak, oh God, on behalf of families this day, my Lord God. Lord Jesus, and that those who have decided that they're going to go their own ways, Lord, that you shall visit them, Lord God. You shall convict them deeply. Convict them deeply, Lord, that they shall humble themselves and change, oh God, and not expect you to change and humble their ways, oh God, but they shall humble themselves and come under your heart order. And according to your instructions and according to your laws, oh God, that you have established in the name of Jesus right now. Read the tablets of our hearts right now, God. We don't even have the words to utter this day, God. But read the tablets of our hearts, needs, oh God, desires, our cries, our moanings, our groanings, oh God, our desperate needs this morning in Jesus' precious name.
Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Don't you dare leave this place as if it is business as usual.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
I will hold you accountable for what you do not do. I will hold you accountable for what you do not say. It is not business as usual.
Yes, Lord Jesus.
Saying no more church as usual, so that's a confirmation.
Yes, indeed.
No more business as usual.
What did I tell you just yesterday? We cannot do church like we do in church.
No church.
Yes. See, I prayed over that just yesterday together.
Amen.
Yeah.
The video reminded me of a dream I had a year ago. I shared it, but I want to share it again because it's so appropriate about getting ourselves ready, rededicating ourselves, praying and covering one another. She said that,
covering one another.
Yeah. Yeah. I had a dream a year ago. We were just myself and some people I knew, other believers, some children. We were like in a home, but it was like a holding place and it was kind of dark. It was like we were in between almost, you know, earth and heaven. And there was a pool and we were, as believers, re-sanctifying our lives, rededicating our lives, or getting re-baptized. And we were all doing that, but especially we were praying for the children first and the younger believers, the ones who were not as close to God. So the elders would come and the ones more, you know, deeper in the Lord and the pastors and pray for the children. And we prayed, we baptized them and prayed until they were taken. They were taken, they disappeared. And we're like, next one. And we prayed and we prayed and we prayed. And if they weren't taken, I mean, they repented and we prayed again. And they were praying even for the younger believers. That was the order we were doing as each one was taken and each one was taken. It was like an individual rapture almost. But I feel that we're in this place where it's a place again of preparation and a place again of intercession. That's what it was, interceding for one another, really making our hearts right before the Lord, interceding for our children and lifting them up to God so that God takes us.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. About it when you walk out of here and have lunch.
Yes, Lord.
You don't go back to what you were. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Hallelujah.
We've got to be different. We've got to be different. We can't be the same anymore. Because God is saying to us, it's time for change. You know, I was very upset yesterday because I had, all week long, I'd been writing my devotions for next week. And I've been writing about the need to learn to forgive. several months ago, someone called me and said, Pastor, what does the Bible teach about forgiving one another? And so I spoke to them briefly, but I felt impressed to do it, so I wrote 5 days of devotions. And then my computer acted up, and I lost all of them. Mm.